Hello and welcome to our webinar today. This is the first webinar in a series of three this month where we will be covering electrical estimating best practices, tips and tricks, and of course, pitfalls to avoid. Today, we're focusing on estimating takeoff methods, materials, and labor. I wanted to mention that our webinar recordings will now be emailed out 1 hour after this webinar. And in the future going forward, that's how it'll work. And we'll also be putting our recordings on YouTube. So you can always go on YouTube and subscribe and hit the bell and be alerted when we have new videos. Most of the videos will be webinar recordings, but we also do other small like product tour videos and feature tour videos that'll show up on YouTube. My name is Derek Delaquadri, and I am the president of Vision InfoSoft. Brian Hoffelder joins me today, and Brian is Vision's training and software development expert and is leading today's webinar. All right, I think we're all set now with the intros, and I'm going to hand it over to Brian to take us through the webinar.
Thank you, Derek, and again, good morning or good afternoon to everyone. And like Derek said, this is the first of three webinars in this series. If you're new to estimating and you want a quick solution, this is always been one of the jokes in the industry, just weigh the prints. Want a very simple solution? Obviously, I'm joking, but that's always been one of the jokes is, how much does it cost? Well, let me weigh the prints. So we're going to take it a little bit further than that today. The first thing we're going to talk about as far as methods is something we've all kind of run across as you come up through the training and evolution of estimating is square foot pricing and unit pricing. Square foot pricing is real simple. You know, how many square feet is it? And you multiply it by some cost factor and you come up with a number. Now, for most of the commercial electrical estimating, just about anything else, that's not really the best way to do it, obviously. It does have some value, you know, if you've been doing a lot of residential estimating and you know how much it typically costs per square foot to do a two-bedroom condo or a 2,000 square foot house, you can extrapolate that and at least use it for budgeting, if not even estimating, if you've done a lot of those types of projects. Unit pricing takes a little step further. Unit pricing is basically just a system where you give a customer a price for a given item. It could be a 2x4 fixture, could be a switch, could be a receptacle, but the unit price that you give to the customer is all inclusive. It's $125 to put in a 2x4 lay-in, it's $55 to put in a receptacle, it's $50 to put in a switch, et cetera, et cetera. Now that obviously has a lot of limitations too, because you have to take it in context, you know, does it matter how many 2x4s you're putting in? Of course it does. You know, so you could qualify your pricing to say, well, this is the price for one or two fixtures, and this is the price for 2 to 5, and this is the price for 6 or more. But it's still, you know, relatively limited to the situation. So typically what people have to do with their unit prices is build in a cushion. So for, you know, for more competitive, more extensive, comprehensive bidding, it doesn't work well. So what we like to talk about and use in the trade is what we call assembly takeoff. And that simply means you count the symbols on the drawing, receptacles, switches, fixtures, etc., measure all of the wiring runs that need to be measured, and you extrapolate that into a list of material quantities, which are assigned prices and labor units. So the assembly takeoff is, you know, count all the symbols in the drawing, measure all the wiring needs to be done, and then extrapolate that into a list of material which you assign prices and labor units to. So that's the most efficient, effective, accurate way to do an estimate is assembly takeoff. And then if you want to take that a step further, you can do assembly takeoff with electronic takeoff. So just a quick couple little screens here, for example. There's a lot of electronic takeoff programs. The one we use mostly with EBM, Electrical Bid Manager, is PlanSwift. This is just a quick little example of a takeoff I started. You can see that I counted some of the receptacles. You can see over here I measured a conduit home run. So that's what electronic takeoff is. Now that's still extrapolated into assemblies. So those assemblies come into the program. The program turns those assemblies into material quantities, which are assigned prices and labor units. So that's our next topic, material pricing. Boy, has that become a challenge in the last few months. I'm sure you're all aware of the pressure and upward pressure on pricing, especially on the commodities. Now, that's a whole nother webinar to do, but material pricing is part of what you need to be able to do to produce an estimate. One resource for pricing are pricing services. We have an electronic one we call Epic. I'm told there are others out there. but our service of vision is called Epic, and it provides updating on about 1.5 million, plus or minus, maybe it's closer to 2 million electrical materials. Local pricing is important too. Sometimes there's some significant differences between local pricing and the more standard average pricing, and there's a lot of ways to tackle that too. Back in my previous life, working in the industry of my father's company, and I think it's still around today, the suppliers will provide you with what I always called a deal sheet, a list of, it could be one page, it could be 10 pages of their typical high moving items and the prices that your company pays for those items. Now that can also be taken a couple steps further electronically. Again, that's probably another webinar, but there are ways to get electronic pricing from your local suppliers. We can talk about that, follow up with that on with any of you if you'd like to pursue that. One source of pricing is the electronic pricing that's available from software companies like ours, and then there's also your local pricing. When you're bidding a job, I think it's important to check pricing with at least 2 to 3 suppliers. Now, I don't recommend going overboard on that. If you start shopping around for 5, 6, 10 different suppliers in your area on a job, that's going to really be probably counterproductive to a point. I think you're better off to stick with the 2 or 3 suppliers you deal with the most. Get pricing from them either on a job basis or get some kind of standardized pricing that you can rely on. I think 2 to 3 suppliers is enough. Some people don't feel comfortable unless they've got 5 or 6 prices on every item they purchase. Here's one thing that I think people just don't do enough. They don't check the price on the invoice against some kind of standardized price. They look at it, they eyeball it, and say, well, that looks okay. Sometimes they might compare it to the quote they were given. If nothing else, if you can compare it to a standard price like the target price on Epic, and if Epic says that half-inch EMT is $60 a 100 and their charge is $75, probably a good thing to follow up on and see if you can do better. And if it's on the lower end, then you know that you're doing well. But just a comparison point, I think people rely too much on just their gut feel, their memory, and especially with prices changing like they are lately, that's all out the window. Those numbers you have in your head, if they're 2 months old or 2 years old, are pretty much useless. When you're bidding a job, it's important to get quotes on the key commodities, your conduit, your wire, especially the large wire, both in quantity and in size. If you want to get a quote on your, or at least get a price on your feeder wire and your branch wire, your MC cable, things like that are critical for a job. And then, of course, you always get quotes on lighting and gear or any other special materials that need to be priced by your local supplier. That's part of the material pricing process. It's expected that you're going to get a quote on the key commodities as well as the switch gear and the lighting. And these days, again, if you can get a time guarantee and a commitment on the pricing, that's all the better. If nothing else, when you bid a job, you need to give your customer a window. How long is that price good for? Is it good for 30 days, a week, today? That's where a lot of the electrical suppliers are right now, is that they're really hesitant to give you any kind of a long-term commitment on pricing. So you need to keep that in mind when you give your quote to your customer, is that the pricing may have to be renegotiated if the commitment's not made from them in a short time frame. So as challenging as material pricing is, the other side of the coin, the labor aspect of it, is probably even a little more challenging because there's a lot of subjective factors that come into labor. One of them is downtime. How much downtime do you expect? And that, again, that can vary from job to job. It could vary from the size of the job to the type of the job. But your labor unit should incorporate at least some allowance for your non-productive time. For example, when I look at a labor unit, whether it comes out of our program, whether it comes out of one of the labor manuals, that should account for normal material handling, setup time, cleanup time, that kind of thing. That's what we call non-productive time. That should be allowed for. Typically, if a labor unit is an hour, we figure at least a third of that is for non-productive time. Two of the resources that are available for labor units are the NECA labor manual, the National Electrical Contractors Association. You don't have to be a NECA member to purchase it. You can go online and purchase it. They update it every 2 years with adjustments to the labor units and new products that come into the industry. And then the means labor manual is also available, and they do provide pricing in most of the trades of the electrical industry, so whether it's mechanical or plumbing, or I think they go all the way down to carpentry and all the other trades. So those are a couple of the late reference manuals. Now, do you use those for bidding? Probably not. But do you use them as a reference? Absolutely. Do you use them for change orders? Absolutely. It gives you kind of a very safe number to use when it comes to your labor units. Again, you need to build in a buffer. Now, one of the things I see people do all the time over the years is, they'll ask one of their key electricians, one of their lead guys, how long do you think it's going to take to put that in? Well, automatically, you've got to put a blinder on and realize that that whatever they think it should take is not enough. If your best guy says it's going to take an hour, I would double that, because he's not building into his estimate how long it's going to take for that setup time, that non-productive time, the fact that the electrician won't be the best electrician. It's going to be something more of an average. So when you're looking at labor units, you got to build in a buffer. It's not just what you think it should take. You got to allow a buffer on top of that. And that's where your experience comes into play. And you know from personal experience what kinds of things are going to be challenging. Those are very important parts of the labor part of your estimate, is factoring in your own experience. Job conditions, size of the job, complexity of the job, those are all things that your experience will help you with. Now, with labor, the other thing we need to think about is, what is our labor cost? I think people don't actually analyze that thoroughly or as often as they should. Labor cost breaks down into two categories. The hourly rate, and I'm talking cost, not what you charge the customer. That's kind of a whole different issue. It's the hourly rate that the electricians see on their paycheck, and you have to average that out for your two-man or 200 electrician crew, whatever it is. And then the labor burden. Now, depending on your position in the company, you may have to get help on this, because it's something that needs to come from our accounting information. Most people look at it as a percentage that they add to the hourly rate. So if, you know, the electricians are getting paid $30 an hour, the burden is part of the cost on top of that. So it would include all their benefits. If there's vacation pay, sick pay, health care can be a real big one. That's all part of the labor burden. It's part of the cost of labor. And then on top of that, there's workers' comp and liability insurance. Those are tied directly to the payroll cost of the company. I don't want to give you any numbers to get out on that. I think you need to do the homework on that. But, you know, labor burden probably can't be less than 10 or 15%, I guess, unless you're subcontracting your labor. You know, it could be as much as 50 to 75% or more, depending on the benefit package and the other insurance and workers' comp parts of the issue. So that brings us pretty much to the end of the webinar. Material, labor, and the different methods of estimating, square foot, unit pricing, and assembly takeoff. There's the contact information. I will give you a quick little preview of what we're going to do on our next webinar. For the next two webinars, June 17th will be 7 Habits of Highly Effective Electrical Estimators, and then on the 29th, we'll be doing one on how to analyze your electrical bids, how to plan for success, how to use that information from your bids to help you do more effective and accurate bids in the future. Again, you can always contact us from our 800 number, email address, or our website. If you have any follow-up questions on the webinar or any other services we can help you with.
There is one hand raised. James, his question, he typed it. He just asked if we still support on-screen takeoff.
On-screen takeoff is one of the two electronic takeoff programs we work with, PlanSwift and on-screen takeoff. We support both of them. Today, more of the customers that are purchasing PlanSwift just for general ease of use and that kind of thing, and it's less expensive. But we do support both. If there are questions or need help with either of them, both our technical staff is up to speed on both of them.
I also wanted to mention that we have a YouTube channel, which I mentioned earlier, where we put all of these videos up there, and you can search and find others. We try to keep pretty organized up there, and we add videos probably 2 or 3 a month, I'd say, up there. And you can subscribe and hit the bell, and you'll get an email whenever there's a new video posted. You can also follow us on Facebook. We usually put a little different content on Facebook, on our Facebook company page. We also have a LinkedIn company page, which is just like our Facebook page. Some people prefer LinkedIn over Facebook, so we put our information on both of those. Well, software update information, training information, these webinars, other videos we post, those all show up on our Facebook and LinkedIn pages as well.
Okay.
We do have one. Rob raised his hand. He had a question about our YouTube channel.
And then I've got Clayton. I'll try to activate his there. Your audio is activated, Clayton. Go ahead with your question.
Yeah, I was curious if you have any import features for third-party SMA programs such as like Accubid or McCormick.
You mean taking information from Accubid and McCormick into
Correct.
Our estimating program?
Yeah, so let me give you like an example, either a base bid estimate or even a change order estimate. If they did a direct export out of Accubid, can you import it into Vision Software and manipulate to your, you know, requirements, whether it's
No.
sorting, filtering, or anything like that?
No, we don't. I think those files are pretty specific to the individual programs. The one thing we can do with both of those systems is we can update pricing on McCormick and Accubid. So that part of our service is compatible, but I've actually never had anyone request to bring a job on another estimating program into our software. I could see where that could come up, though. We have a lot of customers actually who have multiple software estimating programs. It's not a totally unusual thing, so maybe it's something we need to look at.
Yeah. Well, my last thing to that topic would be, you know, with Acubid, you're able to export out to Excel. There's multiple ways to do it, and if there was a reverse import in through Excel, there's some benefit from each program. So I was just curious for the interoperability between the two.
If you could send, sales at visioninfosoft.com, I monitor that email. An export, like an example, just for us to be able to take a look at with our development team. We're always looking for ways of integrating with useful software tools that our customers want to use. So it's sometimes we'll hear it one time and then never hear about it again. So the more we hear about something, the greater chance we have of adding functionality.
Appreciate it.
I guess we should go ahead and sign off.
Yeah.
Thank everybody for attending.
Yep. Check very soon on our social networks and via email, we will be sending you registration invites for upcoming webinars. So keep an eye out for those and hope to see you at our upcoming webinars. Thanks, Brian.
Thanks, everybody.